please stand for the family? shared with you that this is a day of celebration. And that's true. It is a celebration of life. It's a celebration of a godly woman. I would say a godly woman that lived her life 88 years. My gracious, 88 years. Wow. What a life. What all she has seen in her life. And so I was talking with Pastor Billy earlier this morning, and it's not difficult to come and talk and say good things about Miss Sarah. The challenge that we have today is what not to say, because there's so much to say. We'd be here till after lunch, and y'all don't want to do that. Y'all got stuff you have to do, but we're here for two reasons, and that is to honor the Lord Jesus. We're going to remember Miss Sarah. We're going to honor the Lord Jesus. We're going to comfort this family. So I guess three things we're here for today. Miss Lori, Miss Wendy, Miss Sandra, Mr. Allen, Mr. David, and the rest of this family, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to have a part in this precious time in your lives. And please know this, that our hearts hurt for you all. But you can rejoice in something today. And that is that this is a special person that is in this casket here before us, but this is not the end for her. Her life is just beginning as she spends eternity with her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so we can rejoice in that. And some may say, preacher, you're crazy. How can you rejoice at such a time like this? Well, King Solomon said in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 2, he said, it is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. Let me say that one more time. It's better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting. Now, I know I'm not saying this is a house of mourning, but today we're here and we're mourning the loss of a dear loved one, a dear friend, a mom, a grandma, aunt, a special person. Much can be learned about our own lives in times like this, because it causes us to reflect and to look. When we come to this, as we would say, a house of mourning, than it is to go to a house of feasting. One thing that can be gained here today is something that Miss Sarah had, and if she could come and stand before you, she would want to make sure that you had it too. And that precious thing that I'm speaking of is hope. Hope. Hope in a Savior that will love you no matter what, and hope that a Savior would forgive you no matter your transgressions or what you have done. Many people in our world today, in our culture, in our society that we live in today, there is no hope. In fact, they would even tell you there is no hope. But like Miss Sarah, I choose to believe what the Bible says. And there is hope. Amen? There is hope. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. Listen to what is written. It said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy, don't you just love mercy? According to his abundant mercy, hath begotten us again into a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is incorruptible, undefiled, and fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice. So Peter talks about a hope, a lively hope. That's an eternal hope. That's something that lives on and on and on. He talks about a secure hope. That's the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and we know that happened. And we have hope in that. And that is also a confirmed hope, because it is sealed by the Holy Spirit of God. Romans 15:13 says, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy, peace, and believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Peter talks about an inheritance. Oh, what an inheritance. Not an earthly inheritance, but an inheritance that is in heaven. And the greatest reward for the Christ follower, for the believer, is that place in heaven that is a a sign for you. I know we were at the hospital a couple of weeks ago, and they said that it looked like it was going to be real close. And I remember leaving the hospital, and Miss Sarah wasn't doing really well. But then I talked with Sandra the next day. She said, "Mom perked up." And I said, "Well," she said, "what do you think about that?" We were talking, and finally she said, "Maybe her room's not quite ready yet in heaven." I said, "Well, maybe he's putting the final details on her, final touches, working it out." But that confirmed hope, that inheritance. I like what it said in verse 5, that we're kept by God. If you're a believer, you're kept by God. You can't be in any sweeter place than that, to be kept by God. You can never be lost. Never be lost. Lastly, he says that we're to rejoice greatly, and that's what we're here today about. When you come to services like this, you hear three words that are often mentioned in times like this, and they are so awesome, and it's great, and you'll hear a word like family. You'll hear a word like friends. You'll hear a word like faith. Well, I want to cover two of those. Pastor Billy's going to come and cover that last one, faith. I asked the family this, you know, nobody knows you like family, right? I mean, family knows you best. That's where you let your hair down, and, you know, and you're kind of yourself, right, around your family. Now, when you get to church, boy, we all put on that church smile and our church clothes, and we're in church, right, and we're all perfect, right? None of us are perfect, but we try to do a little bit better when we're maybe away from the family. But in the family, we can really be ourselves. So I ask the family this question. What is the one thing that you want to make sure that everybody knew about Miss Sarah? And I like the responses that I got. And I asked them just write it on a piece of paper, so these papers are all over the place here, so this is going to be good. Mom's faith was strong. She loved talking about scriptures from the Bible. That's what Corey said. Isn't that awesome? That is incredible. Sandra said this, faith in the Lord and her love for her children. No doubt she loved her children, right? I mean, my goodness, four girls. I can say one thing about Miss Sarah. She was stubborn. She got that from raising those four girls. So Wendy said Mom was strong and independent lady. There goes that stubbornness. She loved the Lord and trusted in you. Did you hear all three of those girls said something about her faith? Donna were here, she'd say, "Yep, Mom's faith." Don't you know that was just a precious reunion Thursday afternoon in heaven? Oh, that was sweet. That was sweet. Sandy Sandman said this, "Mama Sarah took me and my brother and sister under her arm and loved us like a mama would have wanted her to." That's from a stepchild. Stepchild. That is incredible. She loved unconditionally and was just an incredible, incredible lady. Addie said, "Sarah loved her four-legged fur babies and her grandkids. She especially loved my papa." Isn't that beautiful? From a son-in-law, Adam said, "Loving memories with Sarah, Mom. There were so many, but most endearing are all the Thanksgiving, Christmas, Easter, and birthdays we all shared together, laughing, sharing stories with all extended family, friends, the love of food, fellowship, hugs, and kisses. Love you and miss you, Mom." She was loving, endearing, tough as she needed to be, smart and sweet. She raised four loving girls and grew up strong and loved, and I would echo that. Kimberly said, "Mommy's was resilient. She went so much in her 88 years, and she came out stronger and stronger every time. She was a great grandmother, always having fun with us at the beach, building mud sandcastles with us until she couldn't. Stephen said this about his grandma. He said, the beach. The beach. She loved the beach. Sarah said that she loved her family and God more than anything in the world. And I like what old Brandon said. You gotta like just a simple old guy, Brandon, right? Where's Brandon? Brandon, over there. And this is true of every grandma. Brandon said she was a heck of a cook. Right? That's awesome. Nobody knows my family. What do we learn from that? If it were you right here, what would your family say about you? Would they say, oh, he was a good guy. Made us laugh. Most always in here, we're connected back to love of family. And they were connected back to the love of the Lord that she had. She poured that into her family. See, Miss Sarah leaves a legacy today. Yeah, she was a good wife, a good mom, a good mother-in-law, a good grandma, a good daughter, a good sister, a good daughter-in-law, good sister-in-law, good aunt, good woman. She was a good friend to many. She would help anybody out. I've known her for a long time, since 1984, 85. She loved to talk with folks, pick at folks, had a great sense of humor. She genuinely cared for people. She had a way to make you feel special when you spoke to her. For me, as a young fella, that really meant a lot. She would listen, not just with her ears, but she did something that was very special. That's a lost art today. Miss Sarah listened with her eyes. When you spoke to her, she looked directly at you. And she was listening, hanging on every word. That quality, I'm afraid, is almost lost today. I said a person's faith is personal to them, and Miss Sarah's faith was personal to her. Was she perfect? No, she was not perfect. But she was forgiven. She was forgiven. I knew that she had a relationship with the Lord Jesus, and that was a huge difference in her life. And she had a life of hope. Miss Sarah knew, and she had a living hope. We have hope too. We have an inheritance. We're kept by God, and we can greatly rejoice in that. So we're not saying today, if you have that relationship with Jesus, you're not saying today goodbye to Miss Sarah Dick. What you're saying is, if you have that relationship with Jesus, what you're saying is, see you later. See you later. When I visit her, I'll never forget. I started in youth ministry, and I was up at Northside Baptist Church, and we had gone down. I had to chaperone the senior adults down to Spring Maid at the beach. And I saw her there with Summerton's crowd. Billy, you were not the pastor here then. They cut up and they were acting up and they went to the Krispy Kreme donut shop. Bob Ashford had carried her over there. And I remember seeing Miss Sarah there. She was the biggest kid in that place. Just having a big old time. I remember she looked at me and she said this. She said, I understand you're in ministry. I said, yes, ma'am. I'll never forget this. Your words mean something. She looked at me and she said, I'm so proud of you. When's the last time you told somebody you were proud of me? I was like, wow. That was special. I know she's told y'all, family, she's told you she's proud of me. She loved you. Lot. We talk about family. I want to talk about friends. She loved so many. We want to open it up this time. If there's anybody in here that would like to share a few words about how Miss Sarah may have impacted your life and the impact she had in your life. I would ask you that this time, if you would just stand and be mindful of the time, just share one or two things. It would be awesome. Do we have anybody on this side who would like to share anything about Miss Sarah? It's personal to you. Okay. How about this side over here? Anybody want to share anything? Yes, ma'am.
Sarah was a wonderful friend. And if you were her friend, you were her friend forever.
Amen.
I met her when I was 19 years old.
Wow.
And she was my good friend. And she's still my friend.
Amen. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Yes.
Ms. Sarah always loved us. Unconditionally. She never put a condition on in the conversations we had with her. She always, she needed her advice, but she loved you no matter what.
Amen.
Great.
Anyone else? Miss Sarah was a special lady, no doubt. Again, it's hard to try to put in 88 years, just a few minutes, that you can speak about somebody. But I want to ask you this question. What would your family, your loved ones say about you? That's where we can gain perspective on what's going on right here today. We got a chance. You know what? Maybe we can change a few things. We can change a few things in our own lives so that they would say something that was really good. That maybe we were the one that impacted their lives for the Lord. Thank you.
She loved
A song that personifies this precious lady. You know, it's comforting for a pastor when you stand up and do a funeral for one of your church members and to look back and their life has already preached a greater message than you can ever say about him. Like, what else is there to say? You think about Miss Sarah, you think about her faith, her love, the hope that she lived with, and how it touched your life. You're here today because this precious lady touched your life. And I love that because when I came to be her pastor somewhere close to 10 years ago, I remember walking into the sanctuary every Sunday morning and getting greeted by this beautiful lady and Mr. Truitt with just hugs. Like, there was an instant love, an instant connection that meant something to me. I didn't know what I was doing. I had never been a pastor in my life. I didn't have a clue what I was doing. But she would always encourage me. And always I knew she was praying for me. And there's something, you know, there are those church members that just, you just kind of gravitate towards on Sunday morning. Like, you walk in, you're like, where's my cigarette? I need some encouragement, because you knew where to go to someone who lived in life. I love that about her. And as I stand here today, there, you know, Jim, there's no words. We would fall short in describing the beauty of this precious, precious lady that is Miss Sarah. And family today, there, as I couldn't sleep last night. Sometimes I get anxious about, you know, what all that is that needs to happen. And so God begins to work on my heart. Sometimes God, He's got a little crazy schedule. Like 3 o'clock in the morning, God's working on my heart. Because I'm thinking about this precious family and this precious soul that I get the privilege of being a part of her service. Like, I get the privilege of talking about a woman who right now is around heaven's throne singing the praises of Almighty God. And I love that thought. So this morning as I was working through that, I praised King Saints a song, and sometimes I won't sing today, but there's a song called I Speak Jesus. I love that song. So church, family, if I could just speak the name of Jesus over you today. Like the name above all names. The name where all love comes from, where all comfort comes from, where all hope comes from. It's the name of Jesus Christ. Here's how the song goes. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, because I know there is peace within your presence. Your name is healing. Your name is life. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over your fear, over anxiety, over your loss. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over you today. I'm going to tell you what Miss Sarah spoke the name of Jesus over me. And she spoke the name of Jesus over you. There were many times where I would go by and see her or gather around the table in the fishing hall and we would have a meal together and she would always speak of her precious family and how much she loved you. This morning, I want to read this. The scripture verse is right there in your bulletin, but I want to read this because this describes this beautiful lady. And I got three things that I want to share. You've already heard them, so I'm just going to expound on them today. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 4 through 8, here's what the Apostle Paul writes. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. It does not behave rudely. It does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. When I think about Miss Sarah, I think about this text, the beauty of her life. Number one, we've already said it, I'm going to say it again. Miss Sarah was a woman that loved. Because she was loved by Jesus Christ, her Savior. And she lived out that love for everyone. It didn't matter who you were. It didn't matter. She just simply lived out a life of love. Matter of fact, Jesus goes on to describe that kind of love. And here's what he says to the disciples. He says, by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Well, there's no doubt in my mind that Sarah was a disciple of Jesus Christ. A true follower of Jesus Christ. She didn't just talk about him. She talked to him. Because she had a relationship with him. And it meant something to her. It compelled her to love. And I know there were other pastors in her life. She lived 88 years. I don't know how many pastors she had. But I know one thing. She made me feel like I was the most special. Because of her love. And she treated everybody with that kind of love. This love that Paul talks about is demonstrated. Like love is an action. Like you live it out. It's demonstrated with your life. We've already said it here today. It's an unconditional love that you have for others. It holds no grudges. Paul describes it there. It holds no grudges. It's patient. It's suffering. This is the love that comes from Christ. And every Christ follower is to be this kind of loving person. But Sarah was that loving person, and she lived it out. Like you look at her life, man, did she live it? You know, I love that about her, and I love the fact because when she has something to address with her pastor, when there was something that she wanted to see done a little bit better, or something that we didn't do that we should have done, I mean, she would address it like you're supposed to. She didn't go talk behind your back. She went straight to you. She said, Pastor, sit down right here. And I would, because she was Miss Sarah. And I would sit down with her, and in her sweet little voice, I've got something I want to tell you. I got something I want to ask you. I got something that I want to point out. And she would say it in a way, in her humility in saying that, it drew me to humility where I listened. And I looked her in the eye, she looked me in the eye. And you know what? She was right. I don't remember anything she was ever wrong about, she talked to me about. I mean, she was right. And I love that about her. And I appreciate it. Man, am I going to miss her? I mean, I'm going to miss that. She wanted so bad to be in this sanctuary. She never got to experience it. I would go to her house and she'd say, how's the new building coming? And we would pray for it and pray for God to provide. And she looked forward to the day when she could be in here. Well, you know what? She's in a better building today, buddy. She's in the building God created for her. And this building does not hold a candle to where Miss Sarah is today. And I love that. I love that about her. She was a woman that loved. Boy, did she love her. Talked about you. I'm going to tell you what she said, but she talked about you. It's all good. But she loved you. My goodness, did she love you? Her children, her grandchildren. And we talked about them, and she would say, I want you to pray. She says, such and such has got this going on, and whatever it was. And we would get there, and she'd be in her little recliner, and I'd sit right next to her and hold her little sweet little hand. And hold her hand. And we would pray. We would pray. genuinely loved you and wanted God's best plans for you. And boy, did the woman love her church. Man, she loved coming to church. She loved worshiping. And then there were some days like she and Mr. Truby, the first ones here, like it's like an hour before the service. I was ready to come to church. They were always ready. Ready to get to church. Like it wasn't a question, like we're going to church. Because she knew that's where she get to meet with her fellow brothers and sisters in Christ and worship the Lord together because she loved God. There's no doubt about it, she loved the Lord. And she lived that out in her faith every day. And I went over to her house, I guess, a couple of times, right before the Christmas season, and decorated to a T. Like you're talking about Christmas ornaments and Christmas decorations, beautiful. This woman loved Christmas. And I just were thinking the other day, she gets to experience her first Christmas in heaven. Man, I just think about that. She was a woman that loved because God loved her. And also, Jim mentioned this, that this was a woman of great faith. Like she got it. Like she really understood the impact of her salvation. Like it wasn't just something like she checked the box and she checked out. No, she checked the box and she lived in that box. Called her salvation. She lived it out. Her faith that she had in Jesus Christ. Paul says, by grace have you been saved. Through what? Through faith. But you come to Christ by faith. And she put her hands in the nail-scarred hand of her Savior Jesus Christ. He forgave her of her sins. He gave her a new life, the abundant life. And boy, did she live out that life of faith as well. And it touched us all because her faith was in Jesus Christ. Isaiah 40:31, he writes there, they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Now think about Miss Sarah's life. Boy, did she have some struggles in this life. There was a lot of loss and heartache and difficulties, but one thing that she stood firm on was her faith in Jesus Christ. And she would say, I don't know what I would do without my faith. I don't know where I would be without my faith. And praise God. She had great faith because her faith was in the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter writes that. You heard Jim read it. The believer in Christ, we receive the end of our faith. The salvation of our souls. You think about that faith. It's the reward of the believer, the outcome of faith in Jesus. Is where she's at today. Because she had great faith and a great Savior. That's what we focus on today was that woman and her faith in Jesus Christ. And boy, let me tell you, she would want all of you to know that. She wouldn't want you to miss out on that. She wouldn't want you to know about God. She would want you to know God. Like know Him through Jesus Christ as your Savior. So that one day you can see her too. And one day for all of eternity, we can be right there with her, a little holy huddle in heaven for the people to live in a little town called Somerton, rejoicing and making a lot of noise over the throne of Almighty God. That's going to happen one day for believers in Christ. Do you know that? Do you have that true assurance of that faith in Jesus Christ? The Savior wants you to know that and not leave here today until you have. And lastly today, she was a woman of hope. That's what kept her going. He said, oh, you put all that together. When you love God with all of your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, that's the first thing that we're to do. And then we walk in that by loving others. And that's called faith because it takes faith to live out this life because this life is difficult. She has that. But it was the hope that continued to drive her. What she had in Christ Jesus, all of the provisions, all of the promises, is what kept her showing up and showing out her life of love and her faith. And it should be for all of us that know Christ Jesus our Savior. The psalmist writes in 39:7, my hope is in you, O Lord. That's where her Sarah echoes that very same message. My hope is in
you, Lord. She lived that out as well. In 1 Thessalonians, I'm going to read that because it talks about this hope. Paul, writing to the church in Thessalonica, who were experiencing the difficulty, the suffering of losing people that they loved, and they were mourning. They had questions about what was next. And so Paul writes to them these great words of comfort. If you could just allow Jesus to speak to your heart right now and comfort you with a reminder of what his word tells us. Paul says, I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then those who are alive and remain shall be called together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. It's to call the believer's hope. Peter writes there, as Jim read it, it's called a living hope. We don't hope like the rest of the world. No, our hope is in the greatest, greatest Savior of the entire world, Jesus Christ. We hope in him. Because he lives, we get to live. That's our hope. That one day, through knowing Christ as our Savior, we will see Christ. We will be around the throne of God with Miss Sarah and all those who have gone on before us. But I can only, happen if you know him. And do you know him? Do you know Miss Sarah? We want everybody to know without a shadow of doubt before you walk out those doors that your faith is in Christ Jesus. I'll close with you with this morning. Jesus is his disciples. He's getting ready. He's got them gathered around him and he's getting ready to head to the cross. He's getting ready to go pay the price for the sins of the entire world, by the way. And he's been with them for three and a half years. He's been pouring into them like they were connected. They were close. They followed him. They did what he said. And they grew in their faith. And they were leaning upon him. And then Jesus begins to tell them, hey, I must go. I must leave. I'm going to the cross. I'm going to pay the price for the sins. He begins to tell them all that's going to happen. Because he's Jesus, he knew there was trouble in their hearts. Because he's Jesus, he knows there is trouble in your hearts. And he is the only one that can overcome that trouble by planting within you a living hope. And here's what he said. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But if I go, I go to prepare a place for you. And I will come again and receive you to myself. The creator of this beautiful world that we live in, and I've got to see a lot of its beauty, left this earth to go and prepare a place for us that our little 3-pound brains can't even imagine how awesome it's going to be. Like, that's a hope that Jesus, I'm going to prepare a place specifically for everyone who trusts in the name of Jesus. And Thomas, God, I admire Thomas because Thomas is real. But wait a minute, whoa. It sounds good. But I'm not sure I'm getting it. Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way in? He says, I'm the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Miss Sarah went to the Father through through Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. She is with him for all of eternity. Living today. She is more alive today than she has ever been. And this past Thursday, when she took her last breath in that bed, she took her first breath in the arms of her Savior. That's a living hope. A woman of great love, of great faith, and great hope that is experiencing all the blessings of eternal life today. God bless y'all.
Right now, Lord.